This is Jay Krishnamurti's ninth public talk in Saanen, 1967.
I think we have sufficiently talked over together the question of fear. But of course, one can go into greater details, exploring more minutely, but we'd still be left if we have not already understood with the question which we began with, which was fear. And mere concern with the details of fear does not necessarily indicate, it seems to me, a serious mind. The more one is concerned with details, and however much one may be serious about those details, I think it is far more important to be serious with the total process of not only of fear, but also what lies beyond fear, whether it is at all possible for us to be completely be free, rid of fear, and if one has, what is there beyond? And that question may be rather futile, because most of us still are caught in fear. And after having discussed it during the 4 or 5 meetings that we have had here, I think we should go further and not keep on at that one issue. As we were saying, a petty little mind, a narrow, shallow mind, is very concerned about detail and is very serious about those details. But when presented with a greater issue about which it has to be serious far more, then it hesitates because it doesn't see the full implication of what it is aware of. And we would like this morning, if we may, go into this question of what is the mind? And in going into it, exploring it, we might perhaps come upon the beginning of all thought. And perhaps then we shall be able to come upon something much deeper, which is love. And we might, if there is time and the door is open, we might then find out for ourselves what is the meditative mind. We were asking if we could explore this question of what is the mind, the specialists, the neurologists, the various psychologists, theoreticians, religious and intellectual have defined more or less what it is. Mind that remembers, has capacity to think, both reasonably and unreasonably. The mind that functions not only technologically, but outside, which has certain intimations, hints of otherness. Something which is above and contains both the conscious as well as the unconscious. The whole storehouse of memories which is in the brain itself, which is part of the mind. The mind cannot be separated from the body. And so on and on and on. I think it would be important for us, for each one of us who are here, if we could, for ourselves, find out what one means by the mind. Not according to the specialists, however capable, or according to the theologians, or to the religious people, but actually putting all that aside, if one could find out what actually for each one of us is the mind. Then, after coming upon it, we could ask further questions, which is, what is the origin of thought? Can one discover how thought begins? And that question, how thought begins, and to discover it may reveal still a further depth which we shall go into as we go along. But first, I think we should be able to ask ourselves and find out for ourselves what is the mind that is conscious, that thinks, that has the whole background of time, the brain that reacts according to its conditioning, the brain that is the storehouse of memory, which is part of the mind. Do we, each one of us, find it for ourselves, or we have been told and find what we have been told? And I think this is important, this question, whether you find what you have been told, and therefore it's not your discovery, or you find it for yourself what it is. If you find it out for yourself what it is, from there we can proceed. But if you are merely accepting a theory, a communication about the mind, then you are dealing with second-hand things. And therefore it becomes merely a theory. And therefore it's no value at all. So can one find out what is the mind? You know, to understand this question deeply, one has to be really in a state of meditation. Not the meditation according to some system method, or the desire to achieve a certain result, which is not meditation at all, but a mind that is meditative is free to look, to observe. And therefore a mind that's extraordinarily quiet. And when you observe your own mind, that is your whole consciousness, whether in that consciousness there is an observer which can examine. You're following all this? Look, to examine that microphone, I must take it to pieces. I must see how it works, what is inside. So in the same way, to look at this whole field of consciousness, which is the mind, which is the brain, which are the nerves, which are the whole bundle of memories and so on, so on. To look at it, is there an entity which can examine it? Or is the entity separate from the thing it examines? And if it is separate, is that thing not invented by thought, which is part of the mind? I hope you are getting all this. And therefore it is not separate at all. And therefore it is not the examiner, the observer. Therefore, how is one to find out what the mind is without the observer? Are you getting what I'm talking about? Am I making myself somewhat clear? All right. I want to know what my mind is. The mind. The mind that feels, thinks, the brain that reacts, the thoughts that arise from the memories, the motives, the intimations, the activities, the self-centered pursuits, ideas, beliefs, dogmas, fears, which are all within the field of this consciousness, which is part of me. And I say to myself, I must find out what the origin a thought is, the beginning, and also I must find out what actually is consciousness. And when I say I must find out, is that I, separate from the thing it is going to examine, look, observe, and therefore it's capable of looking objectively. And if it is not, if that I who observes this totality of consciousness which we call the mind, if that observer is not separate, please listen to this question carefully. If that observer is not separate, then how is it to find out or be aware of this total state which is called the mind? You are understanding what I'm talking about? Yeah? So, I must be very clear on this point, whether there is an observer which is separate from the mind. And obviously, the observer is created by thought, part of this consciousness, and therefore, it is not separate. Right? Don't agree with this, please. This, you have to find out that it is not separate. And then, how are you going to be? How is that totality of the mind to be understood if there is not a separate entity who says, I have examined and I have understood? Right? You understand all this? You know, this demands a great deal of discipline, right? Not self-imposed discipline, control, suppression, but the very act of looking, examining itself brings its own discipline. I want to find out. And to find out, I'm asking myself whether the observer is different from the thing that he observes. And to ask that question and to find whether the observer is different demands a great deal of discipline. Not conformity. Because there is no pattern here. So I have, in asking that very question, what is the mind, and whether there is a separate entity who observes that mind, that very question, these two very questions, in the very asking, is bringing about the discipline. Right? Because the mind must be extraordinarily disciplined to find out. But this discipline is not conformity, therefore freedom. Therefore freedom brings discipline. Right? Got it? Is this fairly clear? Not clear in the sense, verbally. Are you doing this with me? We're going together. One can ask these questions because you are free. You have no opinions, no conclusions, no beliefs. And in the very asking of it, there is not only austerity, you follow? away everything except that one question, which may open the door to enormous visions, enormous depths. So, if the observer is part of the observed, which is the mind itself, which is consciousness itself, which has divided itself into the observer and the observed, and therefore that division is erroneous, then what is the state of what is the state, we'll change the words presently, which is aware of this totality, which we call the mind. Please, if the observer is the observed, which we discussed at previous meetings, I'm not going to go in details into it now because we have already done it. If the observer is the observed, that is, the whole of consciousness, which is the mind, in which is included the brain, the nerves and all that, memory, and the entity that observes all this is part of that consciousness, then when I ask myself what is the mind, and the observer is not, then what is the state of mind that discovers this? That sees consciousness as it is, with its frontiers, with its limitations, and so on. Am I making myself clear? Doesn't matter. Because you see, what we are trying to find out is, in asking that, when there is no observer, which obviously is not, who is separate, then what is it that is aware? Right? Now, let's begin. What is it to be aware? I am aware, sitting on this platform, of your, of seeing different colors, the tent overhead, aware of the noise of that stream, the movement of one or two people, the silence. I am aware of this. In that awareness, is there an observer? You're following all this? Who says, I am aware separately of that color, that color? Because what we are going to examine further as we go along is if all consciousness is limitation and all consciousness is limitation, in which there is no freedom whatsoever. Then, is it first of all possible to go beyond that limitation? And is it possible to experience that which is beyond the limitations of consciousness? And who is the entity that's going to experience? I don't know if you're following all this. So I have to understand what we mean, what I mean, what we mean by awareness. To be aware. As I said, I'm aware of all this. Am I aware as an observer, separate from the thing observed? Or am I aware without the observer? You know what love is? Is there an observer who says, I love? And if there is that observer, is that love? And when you say there is love, is there a complete absence of the observer? If there is no absence of the observer, then that love becomes hate, jealousy, pain, anxiety, guilt, you know, all the rest of it, which is not love. Then it becomes merely desire and pleasure, which again is not love, which we went into previously, at previous meetings. So it is very important to find out what we mean by being aware, being attentive. We have asked this question, what is the mind? We have asked that question because I want to find out, we want to find out what is the beginning of all thought. And in asking that question, who is the entity that's going to find out? Who's going to receive the answer? If the entity is part of that consciousness or part of that thought, then he is incapable of finding out. What can find out only is that state of awareness. Is that state of awareness, in that state of awareness, is there still an entity who is aware, who says, I must be aware, I must practice awareness? You're following all this? Look, when you look at the blue sky this morning, those mountains and clouds, seeing the whole depth and height of those of the sky, when you are aware of that, do you say that I am aware? Or there is only an awareness of all that without the observer? Though you see it with your eyes, with your all the rest of it, that very seeing without creating the observer, is to be totally aware, right? When one looks at that tree, are you aware of that tree without the observer? And the observer is the entity which has gathered information about that tree, and according to that information, image, symbol, he looks at that tree. And that looking with the observer is not being totally aware of the whole thing. Right? Is this somewhat clear? That is, to bring it a little more directly, when you look at your wife or your husband, are you aware of the wife or the husband through the image which you have created about the wife or the husband? Or are you merely aware of actually what is? Without the observer. I don't know if you're following all this. Which is infinitely difficult thing to do. I can look at the sky, the clouds, the trees, the river and all the rest of it, because it doesn't intimately touch my feelings, my reactions. But when I have lived with somebody for a number of years, I have created an image about that person. And that person has built an image about me. When we say we are aware, we generally mean the images become aware of itself in relation to the other image, which is part of awareness, but we have gone much further than that. And we say, is this image, the awareness of the image, sorry, I don't mean that. When there is a center which observes, there is a division and hence a conflict. And where there is conflict, there is no awareness at all. And to be free from conflict, one has to become aware. Without conflict, without creating another center, aware of the image that I have created about myself or about another. I don't know if you... So, is there an awareness without the center of this whole of consciousness? Its boundaries, its limitation, its content. And the very contents make the boundaries. Right? Of course. The content of my consciousness as a Hindu, educated, all that stuff. That all that education experience is the content of this consciousness. And therefore the content make the boundaries. So we're beginning to find out that thought has its origin, its beginning in consciousness, in which there is the division between the observer and the observed. Right? Let's put it down the other way. How will you find out for yourself how thought begins? Any thought? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Have you? If you have, how will you find out? And to find out anything, it doesn't matter what it is, your mind must be quiet, mustn't it? The whole of consciousness, not a part of it. Right? If I want to look at you, to see you very clearly, my mind must be very quiet. Without all the prejudices, the chatters, the dialogues, the images, the pictures, all that must be put aside to look at you. And then only because there is freedom and therefore there is quietness, it's only in that state there can be observation. Huh? Right. So can I, please follow my next question. Can we, you and I, observe the beginning of thought? And I can only observe, please listen carefully, I can only observe the beginning of thought only in silence. Not when I say, when I begin to search, ask, question, wait for a reply. I don't know if you're following. It's only when my mind is completely quiet after having put that question, what is the beginning of thought, when it is completely quiet right through my being, then I can begin to, out of that silence, I begin to see how thought takes shape, from where it takes shape, from what material it takes shape, right? Because it's very important, this question, because if one can be aware, if there is an awareness of the beginning of thought, then there is no need to control thought. Because you know, we spend a great deal of time in, not only in schools and colleges, but as we grow older, controlling thought, right? This is good thought, this bad thought, this is pleasant thought, I must go with it, this is ugly thought, I must suppress it, and so on, so on. With control, suppress. And there is a battle going on all the time between various thoughts. So the mind becomes a battlefield. A field in which there is constant conflict. One thought against another thought, one desire against another desire, one pleasure dominating all other pleasures, and so on, so on. But if one can if there is an awareness of the beginning of thought, then there is no contradiction in thought. Am I talking nonsense? Or is there some kind of sense in what we are talking about? I think there is a little sense in it. Because you see, a life of conflict has no meaning whatsoever. A conflict with myself, or with my neighbor, or with ideas. I don't want any kind of conflict, because every conflict is a tension, a distortion. And a life of conflict wears itself out very quickly. And I must find out if there is a way of living without one breath of conflict at any time in one's life. And I can only come upon that discovery when I begin to question whether thought, what is the beginning of thought? If the mind can discover by being aware without the center, then every thought then, please follow this, every thought then is not a distraction. Every thought then has not its opposite. Is this? There is only thought, not the opposing thought. Therefore, it is an important question which has some sense in it and not quite nonsense. One can see that the beginning of thought only when there is silence. So, mind has become silent, not through discipline, not through control, not through various forms of meditations and all the rest of the ugly business, but naturally. As it's only in silence I can discover anything. The mind can find out. Mind can come upon this extraordinary thing of discovering something new. It's only out of silence. And that silence cannot possibly be cultivated. It cannot be put together by thought. If it is put together by thought, it is death, it's stagnation. When thought puts anything together, there is always conflict. And so one comes upon the discovery, because mind is completely quiet, the beginning of thought. It doesn't matter what thought it is. Thought. And because if there is only a thought, it has no contradiction. Oh, you don't see this. You understand? There is only desire. And contradiction arises when there is a desire for that in opposition to that. And when one begins to find out the beginning of desire, then there is no contradiction. Because contradiction implies conflict. And the one who wants to live without conflict has to understand all this. To understand all this, the mind must be silent. And this silence is meditation. A mind that is extraordinarily alive, alert. Every discovery is no longer stored up. Therefore, one comes upon something else, which is is it possible for a mind to be so greatly alert, alive, a light to itself without any experience? You're following only? Because most of us crave for experiences. Going to the moon, or seeing on the television the people who are up there. Weightlessness, to experience that weightlessness of which one talks about, the astronauts, the craving for that experience, climbing the great heights, which is a form of experience, the experience of a little mind that seeks through drugs the state of a consciousness in which there are visions, there are heightened sensitivity, and so on, so on. We all want experiences, don't we? No? The mystical experience, the religious experience, the sexual experiences, the experience of having a great deal of money, power, position, dominion, you know. We all crave for experiences. First, because our own life is so shallow, so empty, so insufficient. And we think that without experiences, our mind becomes dull, stupid, heavy. That's why we read book after book. We go to the museums, concerts, rituals, churches, football, field, every form of experience. But we never ask what is involved in this experiencing. Is there anything new in experiencing? Do find out, please. Don't just agree or disagree. Find out. Is there anything new, original, in experience? Or every experience demands recognition. Otherwise, it's not an experience. If I don't recognize it as an experience involving something, if I don't recognize it, it is not an experience. Right? It's only when I recognize it, I call it an experience. No? But to recognize, I must have already known. So through experience, there can be no new thing at all. Oh, come on. So one has discovered something, discovered a fundamental truth that a mind that is seeking, craving, searching for wider, deeper experience such a mind is shallow because it lives always with its memories and therefore with its recognitions, remembrances. And what is remembered is not the new. So there is no experiencing silence. And then one asks, if the mind is really quiet, silent, is it possible to act in this world? You understand? Is it possible to function in this world with this enormous sense of silence? You are asking, go ahead, can I go ahead? I have a certain function, I have to do certain things as a librarian, as a cook, as a technician, sit in an office and so on, which all demand knowledge, accumulated information as knowledge, experience. And my mind, which has understood and therefore lives in that state of silence, can that function in the office? I don't know if you're following all this. When you put that question, you separate silence from the action. Right? Don't you? And therefore it's the wrong question. But when there is this silence, it will function in the office. You know, it's like a drum. That is highly tuned. And you strike on it, and it gives you the right note. But it's always empty, silent. It doesn't say, I'm silent. How am I to function in the office? So one discovers something, which is that all consciousness, both the hidden and the obvious, the surface and the secret, is part of this process of thinking. And that thinking can only be, that the beginning of thought can only be, can only, the awareness of the beginning of the thought, of thought, can only be aware when there is silence. So when there is silence, there is no frontier to consciousness. I don't know if you're... And all this demands a great deal of discipline in itself, not for something. And then, if we have gone that far, we can then ask, what is love? You understand, it's necessary. Is love within the field of consciousness? Which is thought. I say I love you. Love my country, love my God, love my books, love my position, you know, love. We use that word rather slackly or rather intensely when you are say to somebody, I love you. What does that word mean? And the religious people throughout the world have divided it into the profane and the sacred. And so on. Is love desire? Don't say no. For most of us it is. Desire with pleasure. The pleasure that is derived through the senses. Through sexual attachment and fulfillment. My wife, my husband, the family, as opposed to the other families. My family, my country, my God, my King, you know, all that stuff. And we all call that love, for which we kill others, for which, in which there is jealousy, hatred. Is all that love? Intellectually we say no, it's not love, obviously. Too stupid to call it love. But we are caught in it. I'm greedy. I want money. I want position. You deny it, and I hate you. You are my enemy. I'll talk against you. Or my wife looks at somebody else and I'm in a torture. And yet I say I love her. Is all that love? In that love there is possession, domination, dependence, seeking satisfaction, pleasure, comfort, companionship, an escape from myself. Is all that love? Or Does love lie some beyond this turmoil of thought? Then if you say it does, then what will happen to my wife, my children, my family? They must have security, I must have security. Right? When you put that question, then you are not, you have never been outside that field of consciousness. When once you have been outside that field of consciousness, you will never put that question. Because then you will know what love is, in which there is no thought, no tomorrow. Right? And therefore no time. But you say, you will listen to this, pleased and probably mesmerized and enchanted. But to actually go beyond it, beyond thought, beyond time, because time is thought, thought is sorrow. And to go beyond all that is to know, is to be aware, not I am aware, is to be aware that there is a different dimension called love. And from there one can act, one can be. And from that arises another question. Sorry, don't mind. What is beauty? Is beauty in the object? Or in the eyes of the beholder? Or is beauty is neither in the object nor in the beholder, but in total abandonment of the observer and the observed? Which means there can be self-abandonment only when there is total austerity. Not the austerity of the priest with its harshness, with its sanctions, rules, obedience. Austerity means simplicity. Not in ideas, in clothes, in behavior, or in food, but being totally simple, which is complete humility. Therefore, there is never a climbing. Therefore, there is never an achievement. Therefore, there is no ladder to climb. There is only the first step. And the first step is the everlasting step. And without understanding beauty and love and what is meditation, the real thing I mean, life as it is, lived as it is, with its sorrow, pain, conflict, has very little meaning. You may take drugs to give it meaning. You may cling to your sexual appetites to give life a meaning. But any dependence on any drug or any thought or any demand of pleasure. Only brings about more conflict, more misery, more confusion. Do you want to ask any questions? Yes, sir.
I just wanted to say that you were just talking about experience. Since a few years, I've had a tremendous craving to go up in the glider. And I thought that would be really wonderful. Yesterday, I had the chance to go up with a Swiss
pilot
officer and glided it for 1 hour. Most interesting experience to know how to do it. But when I came down, just as if I had that experience. Was not necessary to do
that. Ah, look at the questioner. The questioner says he went up in a glider yesterday. You've seen them up there, obviously. And he wanted to go up because he wanted to have a new experience.
To do it yourself,
another form of experience. And when he came down, he found that it was not experience at all. He had already had it.
Exactly.
But is it? No. No, you're reducing it to... Look, sir. Why do you crave for experience? Going to yourselves first, whether in a glider, sex, mountain, or taking LSD or TP and getting an psychedelic expansion through drugs and so on, the cough control. Why do you crave for experience? First ask that. And if you didn't have an experience, not one experience, what would happen to you? Is that possible? Now, we depend on experiences to keep us awake. Experience is a form of challenge, right? And without challenges, you know what would happen to all of us? We'll be asleep. If there was no communism, if there was no conflict within ourselves, if there was no political changes, if everything was as we want it to be, undisturbed, we'd all be fast asleep. And challenges are necessary for most of us. Different challenges. And it's that what keeps us awake. And we depend on challenges to keep us awake, which is on experiences, pleasant or painful or every form of challenge and experience we want in order to keep awake. When one realizes that this dependence on challenges, experience, only makes the mind more dull, it doesn't really keep you awake. As you have had, as we said the other day, thousands of wars, and we haven't learned a thing. We are willing to kill our neighbor tomorrow on the least provocation. So, why do we want it? And is it at all possible to keep awake without any challenge? Which is the real question, you follow? I depend on a challenge experience, hoping it'll give me more excitement, more intensity, make my mind more sharp. But it does not. So I ask myself, is it possible to keep awake? Totally. Not peripherally at the few points of my being, but totally awake. Without any challenge, without any experience. That means, can I be a light to myself? Not depending on any other light, which doesn't mean I'm vain. Not depending on any stimulation. A light that never goes out. And to find that out, I must go deeply within myself. I must know myself totally, completely, every corner of myself. There are no secret corners. Everything must be exposed. I must be aware of the total field of my own self, which is my consciousness, which is the consciousness of the individual and the society. And it is only when the mind goes beyond this individual and social consciousness, then there is a possibility of being a light to oneself which never goes out.